The firefighters didn't care about things they didn't know. Inside the darkness of the night, there were hundreds of ionizing radiation sources. Parts of fuel assemblies, pellets from the reactor, chunks of broken graphite rods. Every single one of them was emitting up to thousands of Rengen an hour. A dose that could kill a healthy adult in a matter of minutes. Hello guys, it's another episode about the Chernobyl firefighters, some of the first responders that were fighting the Chernobyl disaster and its outcome. Today, you will hear about their mission. Many people still think that sending them to put out the fires was absurd. Well, it was bad that they didn't have the right anti-radiation equipment, but their sacrifice was important. The fires could have spread to other parts of the power plant, which could then mean even bigger problems besides the open RBMK reactor core of Unit 4. In the last episodes, you could hear about the particular people who were part of the fire brigades sent to the power plant after the explosion. If you haven't seen them yet, it would be good to watch them later. They will give you a nice context on what I will say today. So without making you wait any longer, let's start. Chernobyl Firefighters, Part 3. A thick, strange smoke. Soon after the first brigades pull up to the Unit 4 building at Chernobyl power plant, the chief of Ukrainian Ministry of Internal Affairs gathered the necessary resources and people and set up a crisis center. It was full of dispatchers and other personnel who were supposed to check on the situation regularly. Yet, the flow of the information was neither quick nor helpful. Parts of the power plant could not be reached and others didn't know what happened. A flood of contradictory reports came in. The dispatchers in Kiev couldn't tell what the situation was, which buildings were damaged, or what caused the fire. At the same time, Piotr Kmel, the chief of the first watch of Brigade No. 2 in Pripyat, was surprised by his station's driver, Rodchenko. He knocked on his door and informed the chief that Unit 4 was on fire. Every man was summoned at once. After a night of drinking, he took a half-empty bottle of Soviet, cheap champagne, and entered the car that Rodchenko was driving. Whatever happened, it would be a waste not to finish the rest of the bottle. When firefighters were arriving at Chernobyl, Lieutenant Pravik of the same Brigade No. 2 was already exiting the remains of Unit 4. He and Chavry escaped the death trap this building was, but they had to maneuver through the piles of debris outside as well as ravaging fires. Despite the short time between their arrival and now, other firefighters from their brigade also came to aid. Brigade commander, Lieutenant Viktor Kibenok, was already giving orders and supervising the work of his subordinates. One of them was young Vasily Ignatenko, a 25-year-old fireman, who left his 23-year-old wife Ludmila at home, rushing towards his workplace to join his colleagues in the fight against Chernobyl fires. He was a champion athlete of Brigade No. 6, so despite his young age, others liked him to cover their backs. They could count on Vasily, and he could count on them. It was like a family, a bond almost literally forged in the fire. Around the brave firefighters, besides the noise of the working machines and jets of water, was only the sound of the three remaining reactors humming. The flames were bursting from time to time. Yet, they all knew well it wouldn't end soon. They tried to assess the situation. They looked upon the roofs covered with different debris, and they understood that the power that thrown it out there had to be enormously huge. This wasn't the most optimistic sign. Buildings 3 and 4 were 8 stories high and the debris lying on the roofs was piling up. In some moments, they seemed so big that they almost leveled with a 100-meter tall chimney of the ventilation block. They thought of how to gather more information. With these kinds of structures and without air support, they couldn't properly assess the situation. They suddenly got the idea. The chimney has a ladder. Why not climb it? They thought it was the best option at the time. And so they did. From there, they could look almost straight down. They saw the destroyed roofs, some of which collapsed, others covered in debris. They noticed multiple smaller fires that had broken out all around the main site of the accident. The most disturbing was another thing. They looked almost directly into the remains of the Unit 4 reactor hull. There was a strange glow and a source of one of the bigger fires. A huge cloud of weirdly colored smoke was getting out of this illuminated pile of rubble. Some of the fires around Unit 4 were burning fiercely. Flames reached a few meters high. Others were different, but something caught the firefighters' attention. Despite being significantly smaller, they burned with a similar strange glow as the reactor hull. They behaved peculiarly, fizzing and cracking, even sparking sometimes. The smoke itself was somewhat unnatural. Despite its thickness and intensity, it looked more like a fog than smoke made by burning buildings' insides. And one other thing struck them. The smell was rather odd, nothing like they knew. What the firefighters didn't know at the time was that inside the darkness of the night, there were hundreds of ionizing radiation sources. Parts of fuel assemblies, pellets from the reactor, chunks of broken graphite rods and many others. Every single one of them was emitting up to thousands of Rontgen an hour. A dose that could kill a healthy adult in a matter of minutes. The firefighters didn't care about things they didn't know. The debris, however strange, was a minor inconvenience. Something that usually appears when a building is blown from the inside. So they were focused on the most important task at that time. Putting out the fires on the roof of Unit 3, which started directly above the 3rd RBMK reactor. They checked the wind and were afraid that the breeze would spread the problem, making a small fire bigger and starting new ones. Besides the working reactor being a priority to be saved, the risk of wind carrying the fire to the other two unit buildings was significant. Both Kibenok and Pravik, some of the most experienced firefighters at the scene, knew that if the current fires would not get under control, the entire Chernobyl nuclear power plant could be endangered. And possibly destroyed. An outcome that could result in a horrific disaster not only for the citizens of Pripyat, but for the whole Soviet Union. The chiefs took fire hoses to the roof. Pravik ordered that his trucks should use the dry standpipes to supply the water to the roofs, and that was a significant height. Yet, when the pumps were turned on, the hoses filled with nothing but air. "Give me some pressure," Pravik yelled over the radio at the ground team. What he didn't know was that the standpipes had been destroyed in the explosion. Despite that trouble, all men worked together to fulfill the order. In their heavy uniforms and rubber jackets, they were running around with more and more hoses. They joined them together, ran up the staircases, and supplied the roof team with enough pressure to pump the necessary foam. In the meantime, Chief Kibenok arranged another line. He used a huge Ural tanker, a truck of Pripyat's brigade, which could pump over 40 liters of water per second. Both Pravik and Kibenok were proud of their firefighters. They knew the task was dangerous and demanding, yet they made progress even in such a gruesome situation. The Unit 3 roof finally had a chance. But their men didn't risk their lives by fighting off the fires. Each second spent near Unit 4, or on the roofs of Unit 3, meant more radiation was getting into their gear, their equipment, and their bodies. Each second spent there was bringing a death sentence closer. Thanks for watching, guys. I hope you enjoyed listening to this episode. I know it's not an easy subject, but I tried my best to make it both easy to listen and full of facts, trivia and other interesting things. As always, feel free to leave a comment regarding this video, your suggestions, questions or anything other. I would be grateful if you would share this episode with your friends, as well as if you would leave a subscription, hit the like button and watch other videos on our channel. And you can always check our game, Chernobylite. It's available on PC and consoles. That's it for today, guys. Take care, stay safe, and see you next week.